Welcome back, geology fans. To be honest, we have in the last two episodes seen all three geologic formations there are to see on our campus, besides the surficial cover stuff, though we did see some of that. So what's left to see? Quite a bit, but just remember, you won't see any new formations from the Pier Shale, the Fox Hill Sandstone, and the Laramie Formation, at least not in place for the rest of the campus trip. I say at least not in place, for as we climb up to the parking lot level, we find that someone has placed a rock garden on the north side. That someone would be our legendary geologist, Bob Weimer. In case you don't know, we're walking on the Bob Weimer Geology Trail, and on our campus iTunes site, you can just search the iTunes store for Weimer, or Shorey, there is a video of Bob Weimer giving a tour of this trail himself. His knowledge might be a good resource for anyone writing a report on the history of the Golden Valley. And while you're on our iTunes site, look for the Ron Blakey video. Search Blakey or Shorey again. In many productions, including these videos, you will see paleogeographic reconstructions. Ron Blakey is a pioneer in this field and came to our building to give a talk on how he makes these maps with a focus on Western North America, and then gave a brief history of Western North America. And anyone writing a report on the Golden Valley might benefit from understanding the context of the history of Western North America, given that the talk, starting at about, minute 22, goes through that and Golden exists in Western North America. Alright, but back to Bob's rock garden. The experimental drilling center at the bottom of the hill brought in all kinds of rocks to test from all over the state, and Bob would go down and look at the waste pile and think, I know all these rocks, where they come from and their relative age. I could haul these up on the parking lot and place them in historical order and separate out general Colorado rocks from those rocks you can actually find here in the Golden Valley. So your lab manual directs you to look for a red rock towards the middle of the garden, the oldest sedimentary rock found in the Golden Valley, and you will see it is the Fountain Formation. Just to the left is the Idaho Springs Gneiss, the metamorphic gneiss we glimpsed in Clear Creek Valley, but promised to get a better look at on our Red Rocks field trip. Fountain Formation sure is a red sandstone to even conglomerate. Not too well sorted here, and highly oxidized, but let's save that for our Red Rocks field trip. For now, we can say we expect to find an unconformity there. If the Fountain Formation sits on top of Idaho Springs Gneiss, that would be a textbook non-conformity. So going even further back than the oldest thing we will see on our trips is the Cold Creek Quartzite, the oldest rock in our neighborhood. An old Precambrian sandstone taken down and recrystallized into a quartzite, which amazingly still preserves the original sandstone crossbeds. Of course, Bob Weimer knew crossbeds and put this rock's right side up. If you forget the order of rocks in your report, come here and walk along the rock garden from oldest to youngest, where, at the top, the very youngest formation here is the Table Mountain Basalt. That stuff sitting on top of the Table Mountains. That's right, you get to see intrusive and extrusive igneous, metamorphic, and a wide range of sedimentary rocks, all with interesting structural relationships right here in the Golden Valley. Also, if you are doing research on a particular rock formation and want to see something bigger than a lab hand sample, come over to the rock garden so you can see a big sample of Ewell marble or petroleum-rich Green River shale. But we need to turn our attention back to the exposed rock outcrops we can see on campus, and there across the parking lot is the north tip of what we saw in our Google Earth and drone mapping, a rib of rock up to 10 meters high turning vaguely north-south parallel to the front range with a strike of about 140 overturned again. But the dip is not apparent as we approach the north end of this ridge. To start, this site being at the tip of a geologically very recently exposed rib of Laramie Formation whose mud flanks have been mined away is now an exception to the general rule that our environment is in E-world, erosion world, as opposed to what this small spot is, D-world, deposition world. This is a picture I took soon after I arrived here in 2006. this is what I found in 2020. I did my best to dig it out, and let's pretend I got it back to this level. So we can read that this location has the Pier Shale on the right, the west, and Laramie Sandstone on the left, east. But I'm sure that you wouldn't need a sign to identify shale on the right and sandstone on the left. It may take a bit more experience to realize that is Pier Shale on the right and Laramie Sandstone on the left, and take a bit of memory and attention to detail to realize how bizarre this is. At our first official geology stop, we saw Pier Shale grade into the Fox Hills Sandstone with some fault breccia in the Fox Hills. And here we have Pier in a sharp contact with Laramie, which comes after Fox Hills. And that's a messed up Laramie. Rather brecciated, I'm sure you're saying. And that's a sign. Well, gee, an actual sign that says clay pits fault trace. And so nice to remind us Pier is marine and Laramie is fluvial freshwater deposits, respectively. But did we really need this sign to know a fault trace is here? I mean, just look at the breccia! It's a freaking fault breccia, man! And look at the strike of this Laramie rib and think about continuating it across the parking lot to the far slope where you know darn well there's Pier Shale, not Laramie. Something shifted this rib of Laramie off to the west from the previous Laramie beds we were on. Oh, they should trend off to our east. And if this fault breccia connects to the previous brecciated locations we've seen, and old records before the surface was covered with a parking lot show it is, we can construct them together as so in a right lateral strike slip fault with a bend to explain how everything lays out on our campus. We will have to trust those old maps, as the evidence is no longer exposed. No way to take a strike and dip on this brecciated mess, so we will progress around to the east side of this displaced Laramie rib, and we immediately notice this overall face is dipping to the west, as all the other locations we've seen so far today, and so we can imagine that as all these beds plunge down underground, they initially dive to the west, but bend back to the east, uprighting themselves where they trend into a syncline under Denver, all confirmed with drilling. The Denver Basin is like the bottom of an onion chopped off, and we are on the outer layers of a deformed onion that got pushed so its layers overturned on this edge. But beyond the sedimentary layers, there are these other planar surfaces dipping to the east, and with faint scrape marks that indicate, oh, these are fault slicking sides. There are faults all through this layer. Break, break, break. An emerging phase shows more clearly where one of these faults goes and what it does. If we take the imaginary rock layer in our lab manual and start originally horizontal and then tilt it up to slightly over to mimic our overturned rock rib layer here, we can then draw in the fault as we see it, and the relative motion of the hanging wall going up and the foot wall going down. Now, this is a cinch. You all know this is a reverse fault, and that reverse faults are a brittle reaction to compressive stress. Now take your manual and put it back to original horizontal. Now it looks like a normal fault caused by tension. So which is it? Is it a normal fault that later got tilted to this position? Or a reverse fault made during or after the folding compression of the pig that stood up, the mountain uplift? Right? Context is key, the mystery of the dead cat. So far today, all we see is crustal shortening of mountain uplift with compressional reverse faults and folding. That one strike slip, a little bit of shear. The Laramie was deposited as the mountains were just starting to uplift, and so there was not a lot of time to get tension before the pig compressionally stands up. Everything here is compression without a sign of tension. Context says this fault is almost certainly a reverse fault, and even if it was a normal fault to begin with somehow, it would likely get rejuvenated with the final folding compression to turn to reverse. So, you know, sorry for the confusion, but you all need to remember context in everything you see. why do you think we got the big picture first? So we paced down the rock face to find another fossil of a palm tree trunk and noted it is on the west side of a sand body as predicted. Recall the west side of these sands are the bottom side where fossils were buried. After all, you recall the Laramie is fluvial. That is a river deposit that released crevasse splays across our campus and buried a tropical rainforest under the sand on the bottom side, the west side of the sand bodies. That makes one wonder what will be on the west side of this big faulted sandstone rib. As we start to walk around the corner, we find a small bit of the clay left that was almost completely mined out here. So if you need some clay for ceramics, you can come over and get it from here. This whole rib, it's a bare rock face. It's not what it looked like. There was a gradual slope landscape here, but now that we've mined it out, this bare rock face is a geologically new feature, making an incredibly unstable face susceptible to rock fall, so careful where you park over here. But we also see a sign explaining why some slots in the Laramie held kaolinite-rich mud and why one held coal. It has to do with exposures to air and oxygenation to aid organic breakdown, or lack of oxygen to let organics build up to ultimately form coal. But the best is yet to come. When we come back next time, we will predict fossils around the corner on the west side, the bottom fossil-bearing side, of this crevasse splay. Here on Earth Explorations.